This is the Thriving Dentist Show with Gary Takas, where we help you develop your ideal dental practice, one that provides personal, professional, and financial satisfaction.
Welcome to another edition of the Thriving Dentist Show. I'm Gary Takas, your show host. This is the very first Thriving Dentist Show of 2019, and it represents the beginning of our eighth year of publishing the Thriving Dentist Show. Some of you have been along for the ride since the very beginning. I created the Thriving Dentist Show in late 2011 when it was the very first dental podcast. My goal was to bring authorities in dentistry in an interview format on the show and talk about their area of interest. We've been publishing the show every Wednesday for seven consecutive years, and this begins the eighth year of publishing the Thriving Dentist Show. My plan is to continue to publish, and I wanted to take a minute and say thanks to each and every one of you. If you're a new listener, welcome. If you're a longtime listener, thank you. Appreciate each and every one of you. My guest on today's show is my longtime friend, Dr.Uche Odiatu. Uche is a dentist in Toronto, Canada, and also has three advanced degrees in health and wellness. You know, we're going to talk about some health and wellness hacks to make 2019 your healthiest year yet. And I could hardly think of a more important topic than this one to kick off our eighth year of publishing the Thriving Dentist Show. And I'm going to frame it with a quote. And the quote goes like this. A healthy person has 1,000 wishes. However, a person who doesn't have their health has but one wish. I think you're going to find lots of great information in this interview with Uche so that you can make 2019 your healthiest year yet. Before we get to that, though, we have another Let's Ask David segment. Of course, David is my longtime friend, Dr. David Hornbrook. In this Let's Ask David, Dr. Hornbrook is going to talk about his restorative decision-making process in his practice, how he determines whether he's going to provide a crown or an inlay or an onlay or perhaps a direct restoration. And you'll get a little bit of peek inside David's decision-making matrix. And I think this will be helpful for you as you go through those decision-making clinical decisions in your own practice. Here's that Let's Ask David segment. Dr. Hornbrook, the more I learn about restorative dentistry, the more I realize we have some great choices that we can provide our patients today. Can you help me understand some of the decision matrices that you use to determine restorative choices with my patients?
Absolutely. You know, we had this conversation earlier today about crowns versus onlays versus inlays versus maybe a direct restoration. And you know, I do very few crowns in my office. For the primary reason, you got to destroy a bunch of healthy tooth structure. You know, a patient comes in and a lower molar, they got an MOD amalgam, and they broke the mesial buccal cusp off. We see that all the time, right? In dental school, I was taught to do a crown. You lose a cusp, you do a crown. So, you know, I look at you, Gary, I show you a picture on the screen and say, okay, so you got one screwed up cusp and you nod, oh yeah, look at that. What I'm going to do is I'm going to screw up the other three, bury my margin subgingival, and destroy the tooth to fix that one cusp. When you say that, really?
No, thanks.
No, that didn't make any sense. You know, with our adhesive dentistry now and our materials and the accuracy of the fit of the materials, you know, in that one particular scenario, that should be, in my opinion, an MOD mesial buccal cusp replacement onlay. That's it. And keep our margins super gingival. The only reason we hid margins initially was to hide the metal. It always amazes me when dentists bury a margin subgingival on the lingual of a tooth, especially a maxillary anterior tooth. I mean, why? This doesn't make any sense. So when I do my diagnosis and my treatment planning, let's talk about direct composites. And I do direct composites in my practice. You know, if it doesn't involve a functional cusp or a cusp replacement, then I will do a direct composite. And we've been very successful with those. When I decide whether I'm going to do an inlay, onlay, or a full coverage crown, I go by four criteria. These are my criteria because people say, is that a veneer? Is that a crown? Is that? It's like, I don't care. This is the criteria. One is, and this applies to every restoration I do, remove the bad stuff. Number one, I'm going to remove the existing amalgam or existing composite with decay. I'm going to remove the decay. I'm going to remove fractures of cusps, especially where the pulpal and the axial wall, that's where we see these things break. Number one, remove the bad stuff. Two, optimize aesthetics always. Now, what does that mean? Well, let's say you came in, you didn't want ortho, and you had a front tooth that was outside the arch, buccally displaced, let's say 2 to 3 millimeters. Well, I mean, I could do a conservative veneer on that at 0.5, but now the tooth is out of the arch at 1.5 millimeters. It still sucks, right? It doesn't look good. So I may have to remove 3 millimeters in order to optimize aesthetics. And then that would be up to you as a patient. Would you rather go through ortho and then have a veneer? Or are you okay if we're a little bit more aggressive and leave it up to you? I don't have a problem cutting that tooth. So remove the bad stuff. Optimize aesthetics, always. Third, optimize function, always. Sometimes I have to crown teeth or put at least overlays over the all four cusps if I'm changing vertical dimension. If a tooth, if we're going to restore an implant on a lower tooth and the opposing maxillary tooth has super erupted, and I have to get all four of those cusps back into the arch, I may have to do an overlay or a crown. Optimize function. If we're doing veneers and you have wear on your mandibular canines and I'm doing a maxillary canine, I want immediate canine guidance. The only way I can do that functionally is to wrap that porcelain 3/4 of the way down the lingual. It's the only way I can do it. So remove the bad stuff, optimize aesthetics, optimize function, and lastly, provide enough room for the restorative material. So depending on what you're using, second molar, I need at least a millimeter for zirconia. And the manufacturer will say 0.5. I'll tell you where laboratories see failures is when zirconia has occlusal reduction of less than 1 millimeter. We can mill it at 0.5, but we see that's where it fractures. If I'm going to do a veneer on you, the veneer we can do at 0.2, 0.3, which means I need that much room. So if your tooth is displaced a millimeter out of the arch, buckling, I need to take at least 1.3. If I take one, I didn't meet that last criteria. So my philosophy again now is I save the good stuff, remove the bad stuff. In that case scenario I initially pointed out, if I remove the amalgam and that cusp is the only screwed up cusp, then that becomes an MOD onlay with single cusp replacement onlay. Vertical fractures don't bother me too much. I could show you pictures from 1986, 87, 88 from when I used to do concept or resin-based inlay where there's vertical fractures on marginal ridges and they look exactly the way they do today that they did almost 30 years ago. Where I'll see failures, and I've seen these in my own practice, and I mentioned it, horizontal fractures right at the pulpal floor as it goes to the axial wall, especially on balancing cusps. You know, we can bond in ceramic or resin, but that's asking an awful lot of that bond to keep that cusp from fracturing. And where I've been conservative, overly conservative, and saving tooth structure and had failures is they'll break a cusp. And when I go back and I look at my photos of my prep, sure enough, I can see this faint horizontal line. That's where we see failures. So that's my philosophy. You know, I think we owe it to our patients today, if we're going to practice dentistry in the new millennium, even though we're 21 years into it, or 17 years into it, is that we should save tooth structure. The materials have changed. And what's scary here, quite frankly, is the same book that I was taught on fixed prosthodontics, Schillenberg, is still in almost every university, and they're learning principles on fixed prosthodontics that were not based on adhesive dentistry or modern materials. And so dentists are taught to cut crown preps.
You know, David, I think your four criteria are going to serve as a wonderful guide for our listeners. Thank you.
You're very welcome.
Well, I mentioned in the intro that my guest, he's actually a returning guest, Dr. Uche Odiatu. Hey, Uche, how are you?
Hey, very good. It's another exciting time. I love sharing with your listeners. It's great.
Well, we are going to make this an annual tradition because at the time of publishing this interview, it's the beginning of the new year. And Uche, I couldn't think of a better way to start the new year with our listeners than having you on as a guest. And we're going to talk about a whole range of topics, but all around the topics of health and wellness. And, you know, Uche, I wanted to symbolically start the year with this because nothing's more important than our health, right?
Well, it's foundational. It's our tools. You know, CERACs are important and digital panel-ups are important, but The number one tool a dental professional has is their body. And I think sometimes we neglect it until it gets hurt. So we're giving people foundational strategies to take care of their most important tool in their dental office, which is the human body.
That's right. You know, and I know that many of our listeners, of course, will recognize you from past appearances on the show. But in case you're new to the Thriving Dentist Show, not only is Uche a practicing dentist, a fellow road warrior like myself, and I get the privilege of seeing Uche a number of times a year as we travel around the country at dental conferences. But Uche also holds three postgraduate certifications in the health and wellness area. And again, Uche, you not only you not only understand this academically, but you live it. And I just want to go on record as saying you're my inspiration. How's that sound?
Hey, thank you, Gary. I think we all need mentors in every area, like spiritual, physical, clinical dentistry, communities. So I appreciate that being shared, and it's going to elevate me and what I'm going to share with you in the next 60 minutes, obviously. So
I'll never forget when you taught me a very simple stretch that has helped me so much in my running. It's a simple stretch. You playfully call it the Sonicare stretch, which is a great name. I'm going to ask you to describe it to our listeners, because it's just a wonderful way to start this whole conversation kind of cascading. But when you taught me, it's very simple, very easy to do. It actually doesn't take any more time, because I'm going to be using my Sonicare during that time anyway, right?
Well, multitasking, I think dentists understand that, hygienists understand that, assistants and office managers. But, despite the huge benefits and the documented benefits, like, we don't need another study telling people how health is good for them and their brain. However, the vast majority of the adult population is sedentary most of the day. Mm. So I was trying to figure out little hacks so people can get from sedentary to active, because most people think, oh, I do nothing. So if you stretch while brushing your teeth, if you stretch during the 2 minutes while brushing, which adds up to 4 minutes a day, which in a year adds up to 1,500 minutes, which if you do the how many minutes in a day, it adds up to a full day of stretching, 1 day a year. You can literally ask people or tell people when they ask you, do you work out? You can say, I exercise every day, because flexibility is one component of exercise. So if you say, I exercise every day by stretching with your Sonicare or any brush, but I think Sonicare works better, but you throw your foot up on the toilet, or you can throw your leg up on the counter and just do a very, passive stretch and just sit with it there. And it's not going to improve your flexibility in the purest of certified trainers. So, Uche, that doesn't improve flexibility. But it's better than just standing there criticizing how you look and looking at the bags under your eyes and looking at the other gray hairs. Like, throw that leg up, you can do toe stretches, calf stretches. You can do squats. You can do Bulgarian squats if you want to get fancy. But just to be active during those 2 minutes means twice a day, 4 minutes. And that's crazy. If you think 4 minutes twice a day adds up to one full day a year, how many minutes do we spend on Facebook? If people spend an hour a day, that's basically 15 full days a year on Facebook. Wow. That's 15 full days a year if you spend a little as an hour on Facebook, to give people how much time. So one way to translate that maybe into activity is that hour on Facebook, never sit down. Always do Facebook standing up at your island or standing up at your desk. And then you can make yourself more active, because active physiology says there's an enzyme called LPL that's 15 times more active when you're standing. And basically LPL takes glucose and fat out of your bloodstream into your working muscles. Mm-hmm. And it's great. So you can literally burn fat and get leaner and healthier by standing when you're on Facebook. Isn't that great? 15 days a year.
Absolutely. Speaking of Facebook for just a minute, I absolutely love following you on Facebook for a number of reasons. First of all, just for the inspiration. But I love the way that you will post healthy meals, like healthy meals on the go. So many of our fellow road warriors will say that, the challenge that I have is eating healthy while on the road. I believe that's kind of a mental hurdle, that some people have, because there's no reason why you can't do a little bit of prep time ahead of time and have healthy foods with you, so that, when it's time for a snack, when it's time for a little bit of energy, you're actually going to add, healthy nutrients to your body, instead of the stuff that we find, at the counter of the, stores going through the airports. And I love the simple things that you post that show how you can eat healthy with just being mindful. mindful and a little bit of preparation, you could eat healthy on the road.
Well, you know, I like to look at things differently. I think most people think of, you know, if eating healthy on the road is hard, and it's only hard if you don't have a good reason. I read recently that the National Cancer Institute did some research and showed how airline personnel who fly often, and when you fly often, obviously people know about jet lag, but also people don't realize you're 5 miles closer to the cosmos. And radiation is radiation, whether it's in your microwave, whether it's from your radiation, whether it's from your X-ray machine in your office. So being 5 miles close to the cosmos, you're closer to cosmic radiation. They've shown that people who fly a lot, especially, and they do more studies with airline personnel because they're held captive, they know how many hours they fly and how close they are to the sun. They've actually shown that they have more DNA mutations and more carcinogenic growths in their body. And it's amazing. They actually look at their hours and how many times they fly and the height they fly. And they'll actually send them a text or a warning telling them, hey, you can no longer fly wide body. You got to go to domestic routes because now they're a little lower to the ground. And because of the cancer risk. And so that sounds dire until you go, ooch, what can I do about it? Well, the American Journal of Clinical Nutrition in 2009, so this has been known almost for 9 years, that airline personnel that eat more fruits and vegetables, airline personnel that have more antioxidants in their body, have less DNA damage than ones that eat the regular food that you get throughout the airport on, you know, and wherever else you buy. So fruits and vegetables are imperative if you're a road warrior. But there's no one calling you and saying, hey, Gary, you've done 1,000,000 miles this year. You've flown wide body jets. No one's calling you. They're like, here, have another first class ticket. But they tell you, though, that it's about 120 hours they're allowed to fly every 30 days. And if they're flying the Dreamliner, which flies at a higher altitude, they're told, hey, you got to go back to domestic because of your exposure. And it's some know that, some don't. I was at the back of a plane one time and I was talking to a flight attendant. And she goes, wow, you sure like your vegetables? Because I was asking her for some tomato juice and more apples slices. And I go, well, you should have them too. They go, why? I said, well, because the exposure to cosmic radiation. And one flight attendant said, yeah, I know about that. And the other said, tell me about it. You don't know about it? So some people don't even know about the cosmic radiation and the DNA damage. So I did a little seminar, Gary, at the back of on DNA damage. But hey, it's part of who I am. I love sharing. So whether it's Facebook or Instagram, I love sharing stuff that matters with people I care about. And I love getting little messages, whether personally or the comment section about, ooch, tell me more. What kind of vegetables? Can I take pills? Can I take supplements? I'm like, don't make it too complicated. You must be a dentist. So, and it's all good. And thank you for the acknowledgement. I love sharing. And I think a dentist means a teacher or doctore. So sharing is my passion. And if I find out something new, I post it right away because every time I post, it goes deeper into my own physiology. If I keep it to myself, it doesn't go deep. The minute I share, it goes deeper into my brain and now becomes a part of me. I own it, basically.
Hey, I have two phrases that I want to credit to you because I heard them first from you. May I share those two phrases and can you and I kind of go down the path on what those two phrases mean?
Sure.
So the first one is the concept of a food as medicine. You know, food as medicine. And, you know, you shared that with me and I started doing more research and started doing more reading, read your book, you know, started doing more reading on it. And, I'll give you an example of how I use that, which, you know, that I enjoy long distance running. Mm-hmm. And, you know, one of the challenges with long distance running is keeping your joints happy. You know, you want to keep your knees happy. You want to keep your hips happy. And knock on wood, I think I have some good genetics that way. But, you know, in addition to that, I also make sure that I supplement through food some things that will help me with inflammation and reducing inflammation. And in particular, turmeric. And so I actually juice turmeric. You know, it looks like a ginger root, although it's very, very orange, you know, in color. And I will juice about a knuckle's worth when I make green juice. And it's enough to where you get the benefit of the turmeric, but it doesn't really add anything. It doesn't make it taste any different. But now I'm getting the benefit of that direct turmeric. And I know that that's one of the things that keeps my knees and my hips happy. Is there merit to that?
Oh, for sure. I think people don't realize you are what you eat. And I think a lot of people have system-wide inflammation. I think they said there's about 30% of the American population, adult population, suffers from some kind of inflammation, arthritis. Mm-hmm. Inflammation is a key player in all four stages of cancer. So it's not just your joints. It's prevention of illness. But sure. When people eat, people don't realize what they eat literally becomes their cells, their body. So One of the best ways to lower someone's inflammatory burden, besides scaling and putting on better crowns and, you know, pontic position and design, what, like things that Leanne Brady talks about and David Holmbrook,
right.
I'm talking about food. So the best way, and this is Walter Willett. Walter Willett is a Harvard professor, MD, PhD. He said the number one way to reduce your inflammatory burden is to lower your body fat. And the best way to do that is to change the way you eat. So eating less food and getting leaner, but also eating more anti-inflammatory foods. So like antioxidants are potent anti-inflammatory. And what they do is they reduce the reactive oxygen species. So go back to your microbiology in your body. And it's amazing how they're able to lower your inflammatory burden. Things like turmeric, things like any berries, like all the dark berries are proanthocyanidins and iodines. All the vegetables have major antioxidants. Sure, you can get them from supplements, but whole foods are best because they contain all the coenzymes and cofactors and nutraceuticals inside them. But it's amazing how food, when you think of it as medicine for your body, you can literally look at certain foods like turmeric in particular to lower your inflammatory burden. And I love my turmeric raw. Like you can get the capsules, you can get the powder.
Right.
I like raw turmeric. It's cheap. You know, you can get a 3 or 4 4-inch little finger lengths of turmeric for like $4. And it lasts forever. It's amazing. You can shred it into your omelet, shred it into your smoothies, throw in some ginger, and you can actually literally lower your inflammatory burden, which lowers your exposure to all the modern diseases, you know, heart disease, cancer, arthritis, periodontal disease. It's incredible. So here you are, like I share, you use it, and you're getting the benefit here.
Well, that second saying that I want to credit you with, because again, I heard it from you first, and it's one of those concepts that is simple, but it's profound. You know, I use that, you know, I've shared with you, Uche, that our approach, our philosophy at my dental office at Life Smiles is actually very simple. It's to treat people the way we would like to be treated. But it guides everything that we do. And I love that as a practice philosophy, because it literally guides everything that we do if we run it through that filter. You know, treat people the way we'd like to be treated, clinically, behaviorally, and otherwise. Well, the second saying is that your muscles don't know how old you are. Now, I don't know if you remember sharing that with me, but I remember it vividly, because it was like the light bulb went off. It was like, so obvious, but you're right. Your muscles don't know how old you are. So just use them.
Yeah, well, there's 600 of them in the body. And you're such a good student, Gary, because you teach, but you teach, you also, you have to learn. So every time you teach, you empty out the cup and you can fill it up again. You're such a great master teacher. You also are just a great student. So it's a pleasure sharing with you. But yeah, so someone who's 40, someone who's 60, someone who's 80, if you want to feel young, everyone worries about osteoporosis and osteopenia. They should be more worried about sarcopenia. Sarcopenia is muscle wasting. Mm-hmm. And it literally starts at age 30 with sedentary living. And most adults are sedentary. So they lose about 1% of their muscle mass every year. So by age 70, the average adult American or Canadian for that matter, right, any adult worldwide, has lost almost half their muscle mass. And that's that little shuffle walk. That's that little scared walk. It's a hunched over look because you got to watch your feet to make sure you don't fall. And literally, they've actually shown maintaining your muscle mass by resistance training, by doing good cardio. They said having weak muscles literally doubles your risk of dying. And they show that, you know, having strong muscles increases life expectancy. You don't think of it that way. People always think of their, you know, being financially taken care of and having stress and not having dementia. But having weak muscles, like a poor handshake, not being able to lift your bag onto the luggage rack in the airport, literally doubles your risk of dying. So anyways, you're a master student, Gary. I love sharing. And it's all science. This is actually from the British Medical Journal in 2014. So people always think, ooh, is it from the National Enquirer? No, it's the British Medical Journal 2014. I quote journals. Yeah, I quote key journals. So,
well, hey, let's use that as a bridge to share some thoughts with our listeners about exercise, because you have taught me so much about exercise, including the concept that it doesn't have to take a lot of time to incorporate exercise and movement into your daily routine. Let's just riff a little bit and talk a little bit about exercise and kind of what's exciting to you these days in the world of exercise.
Sure. And the big part of that for me, Gary, is why. Because I think people get so, like, they got so into the minutiae of, you know, what's the best kind and how much and how long. And I'm thinking, if your why is powerful, the right exercise will come along. Like a big part of what dental professionals and healthcare professionals really want, you need a good brain. You know, you can teach if your hands get some arthritis. You know, you can consult, you know, with if your hands have any issues or you have a knee problem. But you really can't consult, do clinical dentistry, write, teach, consult, do webinars without a good brain. And I heard Dr. Church from the Cooper Clinic in Texas said the biggest benefit, 90% of the benefit of regular exercise habit is the brain. And they've shown that exercise slows down the natural decline of brain damage. They've actually shown that your brain shrinks every decade by volume. And by keeping a regular exercise habit, they've actually shown you increase blood flow to the brain and you increase the size of your hippocampus. And this is from the Journal of Neurology 2010. So your hippocampus is the seat of where your memory happens. So we all know patients love a dentist. They love a hygienist, their assistant who has a good memory and remembers their name, how many dogs they've had, or when the last time they were in. So to have a good plump hippocampus and good cerebral blood flow is a mainstay of being a good healthcare provider. And they said the best way to have a plump hippocampus is to have a regular exercise habit. They've actually shown on functional MRI studies, after just 4 months of three times a week, you can increase cerebral blood flow to the hippocampus. And they did the study with seniors, so people over 65. So when you talk about how and why, we can talk about that in a little bit, but the why is really important to me. When I'm talking to listeners who are concerned about, you know, brain farts or just not having a good memory or wondering, you know, how long I can practice. I'm saying keep your brain young and you can practice until you decide to go. And it's not going to be limited by a brain that's no longer functioning well. So exercise is good for your brain. Make that the number one thing of the new year. The abs are important. Beyonce buns are important. Washboard abs like Justin Bieber are cool. But having a good brain makes you a better dental professional.
Oh, I love that that concept. You know, recently I had my actually he's a mutual friend of both of ours, Dr. Brett Kessler, on the show, and Brett recently competed in the Ironman Triathlon World Championships in Kona, Hawaii. And he shared in the podcast episode that this year was the 40th anniversary of the original Ironman. You know, Ironman was started in 1978 in San Diego. I was actually there in 1978 in San Diego. And Uche, you may know the history of this, but I doubt that our listeners know. So it might be kind of fun to share with them. But there were a group of swimmers, bicyclists, and runners that, you know, used to do exercise together, and they had an ongoing debate about which discipline made the fittest athletes. Was it swimming? Was it cycling? Or was it running? So they decided to solve it once and for all by creating this crazy triathlon that was a 2.4-mile open water swim, followed by a 112-mile bike race, followed by a full marathon, 26.2 miles. And the first one was in 1978. And anyway, this year, they later moved it to Kona, Hawaii. And this year was the 40th anniversary, and Brett competed. But the oldest finisher this year was an 85-year-old Japanese gentleman that did the 2.4-mile open water swim, 112-mile bike race, followed by a full marathon. Isn't that amazing? 85 years old.
And that should be, anytime I hear about someone doing something crazy at a certain age, I don't think good for them. I'm thinking good for me. Like, they're a human being. They're not an alien. I'm thinking good for me. So I'm reminded how amazing the human spirit is and how great the joints are. You know, we have 350 joints, 206 bones, 600 muscles. That guy has the same amount of muscles, joints, and bones as I do. So when I see that, you could admire them, but they've also said, Deepak Chopra said, you only admire something in someone else that you have inside you. So if you and I are admiring this 80-year-old man, you and I have that same indomitable spirit inside us, Gary. So we will be those guys. We will be the guy going, can you believe how Gary is? Can you believe how old Uche is? You know, going to Denmark to speak. He's 85 years old and he charges more than he did at 40 years old. So, but so I like admiring people because I know you can only admire people if they have the traits you do. And I think many times we admire people and think they're different than us, but some people don't recognize that. You know, they'll look past that old guy and think, oh, old guy. But you and I think amazing spirit, amazing energy, amazing life force. And that's because we have it. So, you know, in a crowd of pockets, in a crowd of people, all the pickpocket sees is the pockets. they only recognize what they're focused on. You and I are focused on becoming better, becoming healthcare providers, becoming better consultants and speakers. So we notice things in our world that'll help us do what we do better. And that's a beautiful thing. So you and I recognize that 80-year-old man's abdominal spirit, because you and I are moving that direction. We will be on CNN someday, you know, the best lives, and you and I will be featured probably somehow. I'm just channeling that from somewhere. But I could totally see that, Gary, you and me.
Well, I appreciate your thoughts about that, and I will strive to be right there with you. Hey, you know, here we are at the beginning of the year. Many of our listeners are at the time where they're, you know, setting goals, working on the things they'd like to achieve during the year. And I know for many people, there's a, you know, kind of a dialogue they have in their head that I would like you to help recraft for them. And that is that they don't have time for exercise, or they don't have time to do as much exercise as they would like. And you have such amazing a counter to that, that we can make the time for quality exercise. And in fact, it doesn't have to take long form exercise to provide really incredible benefits. Would you share a little bit of your thinking about that to our listeners?
Yeah, I think everyone, I think when you talk about it, you know, the American College of Sports Medicine in August 2017 showed that most adults are sedentary, which is a shame. And dentists are normal. Dentists are just as sedentary as the rest of us. And I think many people have the belief that it's hard. It takes at least an hour a day, possibly 2 hours. You got it. You can't miss a day. You got to love it. If you exercise, you got to be an athlete. You got to look great in spandex, okay? You need a high-end personal trainer. You got to have all your foods ordered from Whole Foods. It takes a 30-minute warm-up, you know, a 30-minute cool-down, and you can't miss a day. It's all or nothing. And it couldn't be so wrong. And what happens is when they make it hard, when they make it a long time, that's what makes people not even get started. So I'm all about efficiency. And there's a book, really good book, called The 1-Minute Workout by Martin Gabala, a professor at the McMaster University. And he said, interval training, bar none. So he had one of the most downloaded articles in exercise physiology in 2015 on how interval training is the fastest way to improve your VO2 max, which is the gold standard of measuring aerobic capacity. And it was keen on showing how in as little as 2 weeks, so three sessions, so six sessions over 2 weeks, someone can basically double their time to exhaustion on a stationary bike if they've never worked out before. So if you take a dentist who's never trained before, and they do six 30-minute sessions. Within those 30-minute sessions, they have peak times where they do a 1-minute session where they go all out in that 30-minute session. They can actually double their time to exhaustion. So in that study, they showed how they went from 27 minutes to exhaustion to 54 minutes. In as little as 2 weeks, it wasn't the summer, it wasn't a year, as little as 14 days, people double their time to exhaustion using interval training. So you don't need to train hard and long. You don't need special equipment. You don't have to be looking in Lululemon. You know, you don't have to shave your body. You know, you can actually do it in old workout clothes. And interval training doesn't have to be on a station bike. You can actually do it walking, just by altering the intensity, fast, slow, fast, slow.
Are you sharing with me that one way that this could be done without, you know, fancy, expensive equipment is with the jump rope?
Well, that's one. It's sure. And for some people, that it takes a little bit of athletic ability to even do a jump rope. So basically, you can run on the spot. So running on the spot for 60 seconds, and then you get on the floor and do mountain climbers for 10 seconds. And then you get up and then you walk or, you know, on the spot for 60 seconds to recover. Then you go down on the ground for 10 seconds, do mountain climbers. And then you get up for 60 seconds and you walk on the spot to recover. Then you go down again, you do mountain climbers. You do that for 4 to 5 minutes. Basically, they've shown Professor Tabata in 1996 and Martin Gabala and his studies have shown at McMaster University that it is equal to or better at boosting aerobic capacity and aerobic fitness than steady state training. So, but not to discount marathon training, like you run marathon and half marathon. So you need to train in the energy state that you do. But they've shown that marathon runners though, and half marathon runners and long distance running, the ones that are hitting the records are the ones that are using interval training as part of their workouts. So sedentary people can use interval training and get in shape. And you don't have to run a marathon. If you don't have 2 hours a day, you have 5 minutes. And I have a great handle. I think I've made it available before, but I can make it available again for you. And it's called Exercise When Less Is More. And it's all about how easy it is to do that 5 to 7 minutes most days, not even every day. We're talking most days, and improve your ability to use oxygen, which is VO2 max, and that's a gold standard ability. It measures how well you take in oxygen, use it, and send it out of your body.
Uche, with your permission, may I put that handout in the show notes?
So, for sure, any
of our listeners are interested, they can get access to that.
Yeah, for sure. My pleasure. No, I'll do that for you.
Perfect. Perfect.
I'll do that for you. Pleasure.
You know, another area that I think a lot of dental professionals struggle with, and it's something that I think is there's a mythology around it, and that is the importance of quality sleep. I hear some very high powered people that you and I both know. You know, I've heard them say, I don't need much sleep. You know, I can get by on just a minimal amount of sleep. But actually, physiologically, you can't. Sleep is required to maintain good health. Am I correct?
Oh, it's fundamental. But most people never look at it as one of their New Year's resolutions. Most people want to work out. They want to go back into the piano. They want to, you know, do all these things. No one ever says in 2019, I'm going to sleep longer and harder than anyone I know. Like, that is not on anyone's list.
No.
So, but sleep is foundational. I think as when I look at patients, whether it's apnea, snoring, restless leg, or just people who don't sleep deeply or long enough, I don't know any patients that are completely healthy and are poor sleepers. Actually, even on my new patient exam, or even my recare exam for that matter, one of my first questions is, how well do you sleep? Or how well have you been sleeping? If they say horrible, I'm not going to have more bleeding. Mm-hmm. I know that it's impossible to be healthy and be a poor sleeper. So people who are fairly fit and are poor sleepers, think how much better you would be if you mastered sleeping deeply and for long enough time, which is 7 to 9 hours. There's no getting around it. Michael Howard, he's a PhD, he's a neurophysiologist, said that anything less than 7 hours a night on a regular basis puts you at risk for 7 serious diseases, heart disease, Alzheimer's, and cancer. So there's no doubt that you need more than 7. So there are times when I get less than 7, but I am again, consciously setting myself up at risk. So it's never 2 nights in a row, but I can go a night with poor sleep, mm-hmm. but I will not go 2 nights because I don't want to sabotage my health. It's too important to me, my family, my patients.
Right, right. You know, you shared in the past, you know, we love technology. I do. I consider myself a nerd. And Uche, I would use that label with you as a term of endearment. You're a fellow nerd. And yet, staring at the computer as we get ready for our, you know, bedtime routine probably isn't helping us with quality sleep, is it?
Well, no, there's a blue light that's transmitted, and Harvard did a great study. If you want to look this up, look up Harvard blue light orange glasses. And we're not talking about People magazine. It's a great magazine. This is a great, you know, prestigious university. And in their public health bulletin, they posted a great study that showed how exposure to blue light before you go to bed sabotage your sleep. And people say, well, I can go to sleep after being on the phone. I can go to sleep after watching TV. Well, guess what? Because you don't sleep as deep after blue light exposure, which sets you up for waking up after 8 hours not feeling too good, or you can over a few days not feel great at all. But they said over several months or years, you can start having organ dysfunction simply by the fact that melatonin is a key hormone. It doesn't help you get to sleep. It helps you stay asleep. And it's made by your pineal gland. And exposure to blue light sabotages your pineal gland making melatonin. So even right now, so I'm at my computer. So I'm wearing, I have certain glasses right now that take out 80% of the blue light from my computer. So you can either have an app that brings on almost like an amber hue to your screen, right, or you get glasses on Amazon. I can name a bunch of names, but what it does is it filters out the blue light. So what it does is you can still look at this. You can still go out to the garage and put your garbage out. You can still go to the bathroom with the light on. However, the one I'm wearing right now is an 80% filter. I wear these orange glasses, which are almost 100% filter of blue light, which basically worn within an hour of bedtime, sets the tone for your brain to have deep, restful sleep. And that's my take on with the orange glasses. It's an easy hack to do. They cost anywhere from $20 to $60. I'm not sponsored by them at all, but what a great find for me, because I was all over it when I heard about them. I was all over it.
I love these health hacks because I'm taking notes as we're talking and adding things that I'll be adding to my health routine. Let's on the same theme of hacks, let's talk about hydration. And I think that's something else that seems to crop up for a lot of different people is that they aren't staying properly hydrated. Do you have any data and information about that?
Well, the whole thing about it, people want to know how much, and you know, how could the 102-pound, you know, 85-year-old grandmother need 8 glasses a day, and the 300-pound lineman for the Toronto Argonauts need 8 glasses a day? So it depends on your body size, it depends on your activity level, and it depends on the heat. So obviously, in Arizona, mm-hmm. in the heat, you need to have more glasses than someone in Toronto who doesn't have the heat that you have, the above 100 degree temperatures. But every chemical reaction in the body needs water. The human body is anywhere from 60 to 70% water. And anyone that's not staying hydrated, and football coaches know that. They know that if a football player playing in the sun is dehydrated and they've lost 1% of their body weight, which is about, 3 pounds, their mental functioning, their focus is off. So if college football players have less mental focus being dehydrated and all they're doing is practicing, what does that mean to the 180-pound dentist in New York City? What does that mean to the 150-pound dentist in San Diego? If you're dehydrated, if you're just eating coffee and tea, which are diuretic drinks, and not hydrating with whole foods or fruits or filtered water, you're sabotaging your mental focus. And who would brag about having poor mental focus all day? Who wants to have a poor, cognitive functioning? So water is not just about looking, having great skin, which, Janice Hurley is all about, giving image advice and telling us, stay hydrated and look great. It's mental functioning. Like, it goes back to mental. Like, people always think, hydration is about having your skin look good. That's great. However, having a good brain is preeminent if you want to be a good healthcare provider. So a good sleep makes you have a good brain. Exercise, which we talked about earlier, keeps your hippocampus full and plump. And now we know that hydration keeps your mental functioning and your reaction time on par. So it comes back to the brain. And I don't think I've talked about the brain with you this much before, but you think about this central processing unit with 100 billion neurons and about 10,000 synaptic connections each one makes. It's the most complicated thing in our known universe. And most of us have no idea how it works. We have no idea. We have no idea where the manual is. But you and I, in the last 30 minutes, have discussed 3 things, which is give people a better brain. This can be a better podcast, Gary. I'm getting more juiced as I talk.
Well, and I'll stay on this hydration topic for just a minute, too. And that's that I think sometimes people misplace hunger for thirst. And we feel an urge for hungry, we need to eat something when in fact it may actually be, the body crying out for some hydration.
Yeah. There's a book actually called, it's by Dr. Bandelage, and it was called The Body's Many Cries for Water. And you're saying a lot of illnesses, you start hydrating someone, they'll get better, whether it's ulcers, whether it's, headaches, hydration. Sometimes you're a little bit hungry and you think, oh, it's 9 o'clock at night. Maybe I shouldn't eat. Have a glass of water. It can be filtered. It can be tapped. It doesn't really matter to me. People make it too complicated. I would often squeeze some lemon in it. Mm-hmm. But I would go to water first for me as a first line of defense. It's amazing people actually don't go to water first. They want to go to an Advil. They want to have a sandwich or they want to raid the refrigerator. Try water and make it fun. Squeeze a bit of lemon in. Drink it with a straw if you don't want to erode your enamel, because enamel is very susceptible to erosion, right? If someone has lemon water, so with a straw. But there's nothing like water to make you feel better. And keep it simple. I would say I'll actually bring a 1 liter or 1 quart container with me to work, and I make sure I fill it up twice during my 8-hour day. And that gives me about 6 glasses. And I finish those 6 glasses before, 5 o'clock in the afternoon, which is important though, because I had a patient one time come in for a recare exam, and he said to me, he was in his 60s, and he said, "Uche, I'm thinking I'm going to retire soon." I go, "Why?" He goes, "I'm so foggy." He goes, "I feel so tired all the time. I'm losing my mojo." And I said, "What's new?" And he goes, "I'm up all night peeing. You get to a certain age as a man, and you have benign prostate hyperplasia, and you get up all night peeing." I said, "Well, that's interesting." I said, "When did that start?" He goes, "I started taking this prescription medication." I go, "When?" He goes, "I said, when do you take it?" He goes, he named the name of it, Aldactone. And I said, "Hey, that's a diuretic." He goes, "What does that mean?" I said, "It makes you pee." I said, "When do you take your diuretic?" He goes, "I take it before bed." I said, "You're a lawyer?" He goes, "Yeah." He goes, "You take your diuretic before bed?" I said, "Do you think it has any influence on you peeing all night?" He goes, "Oh my God." And he hit his head. He goes, "I can't believe it." 4 months later, he comes in. He almost hugged me in the waiting room. I'm like, forget the veneers I put on him. He goes, "Uche, you saved my career." He goes, "Who would think a dentist would know to take your diuretic in the morning?" I said, "You know what? I bet you your doctor told you to take it in the morning, but most men have to hear it from a third party, objective person like myself."
Right.
And here he is. He goes, and he's alert. He was bright-eyed and bushy-tailed. So it's amazing how dentists often think that we're not qualified to talk about nutrition. But on average, most dentists take anywhere from 20 to 40 hours, while the average physician is under 15 hours in their 4 years of training. So dentists and hygienists, for that matter, too, take about 20 hours in their college training. So it's well within our scope of practice to talk nutrition with patients. And if Hippocrates, who was the first doctor in 300 BC, said, let food be your medicine and medicine be your food, you know, nutrition is foundational. So whether it's water, whether it's food, whether it's fruit, whether it's talking about lemon drunk with straws to not erode the enamel, we are perfectly equipped to talk about with the patients. And you know what? Patients are starving to hear about a healthcare provider talk to them, because many times physicians are so busy dealing with, you know, major complaints and diseases. We're preventative experts, like the dentists and hygienists. We're the preventative kings and queens of this thing, and we know our stuff. So it's well within your scope of practice, doctors and hygienists out there, to talk nutrition, because we take enough. We take about twice as much as the average medical doctor in their 4 years of training. So talk about omega-3s, talk about hydration, talk about probiotics, talk about antioxidants. Don't be afraid. Bring it up and show yourself as an oral physician. Show yourself as the true provider of care, of the gateway to the whole body. And your patients will start seeing you in a completely different light. You're not just going to be a tooth mechanic or a prophy queen. You're going to be an oral physician or a wellness expert. And that's where you start elevating your status in your community. And that's where you start elevating your status and getting referrals like crazy, because you won't compete with anyone. If you want to talk wellness, and I'm not just talking about amalgams to resin and amalgams to porcelain. I'm talking, you talk wellness, patients are starving for healthcare providers to talk wellness with them. And we are perfectly equipped, Gary. So I'm sorry, that was a bit of a rant there.
I love this rant, because you're absolutely right. You know, if we look at our colleagues on the medical side, sadly, because of many factors, not the least of which is, the ever-increasing participation in managed care and preferred provider organizations, you know, the average physician has somewhere between 4 and 5 minutes to spend with every patient. They literally don't, they might see 100 patients a day. And we don't have to practice that way in dentistry to have a quality practice. And we can slow things down to actually talk to our patients. And I love what you suggested is when we're talking to them about prevention, in their patient's mind, we are becoming elevated in their mind as being the source of health information that's going to help them live a long, healthy, happy life. And what a better position to be in with your patients than that perspective.
Well, it's a beautiful thing. I think people often think, again, you know, dentists are tooth mechanics. On the airplane, if they said they have a person that's not feeling well in the business class cabin, is there any doctors on the plane? If you're a cosmetic dentist in Seattle and you put up your hand and go, I'm a doctor. And they go, what kind? I'm a dentist. Sit down. You know, so they think, what are you going to do? Bleach their teeth to get better? So no, I am an oral physician. I know CPR. I know how to look at vital signs. I might be the only person between that person and living. Let me get up there. And you got to look confident. You know, you can't be, I bleach teeth. I do veneers.
Right.
No, I'm an oral physician. I know nutrition. I know how to take vital signs. Let me see what's going on in there. And come forward with confidence. But you can only do that if you're reading. Read the clinical stuff. It's important. But you got to read some nutrition journals. You're going to have to read some good books on exercise and physiology. You have to read some good books on sleep medicine. You got to read some good books on hydration and the latest stuff on nutrition in The Lancet, New England Journal of Medicine. And then you'll feel much more confident striding to the front of the plane to assess someone and not think, oh, I bleach teeth. I better not tell anyone, you know. So it's a beautiful thing to feel confident as an oral physician or a wellness expert, as a hygienist out there, because the world is starving for us. They're waiting. And and the practices you talk wellness, they're doing very well. And you're not competing with anyone when you talk wellness. Like, you, speed of a crown, cost, yeah, you'll compete with people. You talk wellness, you don't compete with any. You know, we have 5 different offices on our floor where we are. I don't even know all the dentist names there. It doesn't matter, because I'm talking wellness. They want to see Uche. I'm booked out, and that's important to me. And I care deeply for my patients.
Hey, let's talk about another fundamental. And I know from our conversations that you have upped your game when it comes to yoga. And Therese, my wife, is smiling, ear to ear, because her life's work is yoga. And let's talk a little bit about, stress relief and breathing a little bit. I know that there's some hacks that we can do there with our breathing that can help us reduce stress and help us, enjoy the benefits of that.
Well, many people think, when they think of exercise, they think of jogging or they think of working out. Most people don't think of flexibility. And people who do yoga, like, you know, in the community where we live, there's about 300,000 people in Markham, which is a part of the GTA, the Greater Toronto Area. And I have an unlimited yoga pass. So I go about 3 to 4 days a week, hot yoga. And doesn't take a lot of time. It's 4 hours of the 168 hours in our week. There's never any men in the classes. Lots of women. Women get it. They're flexible. They're not shuffling around like men over 70, but they're limber and happy. And flexibility is one of the components of being physically fit. And a big part of doing dentistry is, you know, poor posture. Even with loops and the great chairs and ergonomic, all the equipment you have, these dentists, they've been practicing dentists for 30, 40 years, their backs and necks and hamstrings are so out of whack. They look horrible. They walk horrible. They can't, you know, they can't even take the card out of their back pocket and give it because they're so bent out of shape. But I find that I've been doing yoga as a student for probably since 2007. I got certified last year, and I don't have the 200-hour status that your wife has, Therese. Right. But I can do a pretty cool class, and I bring a lot of neat spirituality to it, and a lot of my nutrition and my Tony Robbins stuff, you know. And I think like a dentist, nerdy, obsessive compulsive, the microcosm, the minutia. So I get them focused on things other than their pain in their back. But it's a really fun way for me to share with people how, especially men, because I hardly ever see men in these classes. So men need to do more flexibility training, and women need to do more weight training, because women, sarcopenia and muscle wasting is deadly for women. And for men, being inflexible will have you walking like an old man so quick.
Right.
So having a good yoga teacher and going to a nice beginner class and sitting at the front so everyone can look at you and give you correction. You got to lose your ego, but it's life changing within months. If you do it, I couldn't touch the floor in 2006, 2007, I was doing the Humble Warrior. So, and I'm not a flexible guy. Like, you know, in a seminar one time, Tony Robbins said, bend over and touch your toes. I had to touch the toes of the person next to me because, I could not touch my own toes.
Right.
So, now I'm having fun. I'm enjoying my class. I'm working at my own speed. I know it's all about the breath. It's not about looking good. Mm-hmm. I do like my Lululemon, but yeah, it's great. My Sonica stretch has improved. You know, I'm using the high counter now in our bathroom, but nothing like flexibility training. And I said, it's an easy way to start. If you don't want to go to yoga class, especially the men out there, is just do 2 minutes twice a day, stretching on brushing your teeth, throw your leg up on the counter or throw your foot up on the toilet and do a little archer stretch to stretch out your hip flexor, which makes your glutes get back into gear. A lot of men have flat glutes, and you know, you don't fill out your jeans that well. So only the people behind you know that, you know. But the whole idea is though, what happens is if you have tight glutes, you have tight hip flexors, you have flat glutes, which means your butt has forgotten how to fire. So it's so important to get more less tightness to the hip flexors, so your glutes can position themselves better, and it loosens up the whole thoracic area, lumbar area, and you can literally get rid of back pain by improving flexibility. So it's wonderful, and I'm inspired by Therese. I see some of her posts about the way she's in, you know, got the chakras involved and smudging it. It's really quite cool. I love it.
I'm very fortunate to have her as my private yoga instructor, and it's really helping my flexibility. It's helping with my running. It's helping, you know, in terms of breathing regulation. All of it is helping. Hey, as we come here into the finish line on this interview, Uche, I want to close by talking about something that I think will be very important for all of our listeners, and that is some tips on how we can make new habits actually stick. You know, because sadly, for many people, you know, they'll make commitments or resolutions, and they have a hard time making them stick. Can you share some thoughts about what we can do to make our new habits stick?
Yeah, I think a lot of people are called poor parallel processors. Like, people don't have the ability to work on two or three or four things at a time. I think I've had people that I've coached. I do some coaching. So I'm a lifestyle coach. People actually say, "Uche, I want to do seven things better." I said, "You can't improve seven things." I said, "Get a business card." I know we all have these virtual cards now. We, you know, we scan in barcodes and all these Q codes, but get an old-fashioned business card. On the blank side, put down the one thing you're working on, and carry it with you. I'd say for at least the first month. So think of 12 months to the year, and carry that one thing. So flexibility is your one thing. Put flexibility. Don't even make it complicated by how many times. Just put flexibility. And what it does is, if you look at it 2 to 3 times a day during the day, what happens is it'll make you more mindful to how you're sitting. It'll make you more mindful that you're sitting and should be standing. It'll make you more mindful, think, hey, I'm on Facebook and I got to stand at the kitchen island when I'm on Facebook. What it does is, because human beings are poor parallel processors, one thing at a time. So one way to make a habit stick is don't try and improve seven things at once. Just write flexibility or resistance training or staying hydrated or go to bed and get 7 hours sleep. And it'll make it more likely by June, you will have six new habits instead of none, because the average person falls off the wagon after 3 weeks.
Man, I love the simplicity of that and the compounding effect. Like you said, at the end of 6 months, you're going to have six new habits that are likely going to be habits that are sticking for you. How cool is that?
For sure.
Well, I wasn't sure where you're going to go with that, Uche, but as I've come to expect, you hit that one out of the park. Hey, Uche, I want to just take a minute and say thanks, man. First of all, I always love it when you and I are together at meetings. We get a chance to see one another throughout the year at different times, and I always love when I get a chance to catch up with you. We had a wonderful time with your family when you were out here a couple of years ago out here in Scottsdale, and we got to spend some time not only with you and Carrie and the kids. We just had a great old time. And it's always so fun seeing you out and about. But just want to say thanks, man. Thanks for all your inspiration. Thanks for all that you do. Thanks for being an inspiration when it comes to health and wellness.
Well, I owe it all to my mom. You know, I'm a vessel. I'm a vehicle. This stuff doesn't come to me. I read, I memorize, I learn, I prescribe, I listen to audiobooks. And it all started with my mom and dad. My dad had me in the basement of our house, even back in England, doing yoga. He'd bring us downstairs and say, "We're going to do yoga." And I'm like, "What the heck is that? This is in the 60s. What the heck is yoga?" And I'm six, Dad. I don't do yoga. You know, I need to be outside. No, yoga is an ancient way of movement. And now here I am at 55. He's long since passed away. And this gentleman, you know, passed away 8 years ago. But my yoga practice and my physical fitness is testament to him. And my mother, who passed away just 2 years ago at 92, amazing lady. And, you know, I think Abraham Lincoln said, "All that I am and all that I hope to be is because of my mother." And I really believe that moms, you know, the power of the feminine spirit, like, you know, honor to Therese and all the amazing mothers out there, you know, Carrie and Eric, incredible. And they are the lifeblood. It's not being sexist, but the lifeblood of the conventional traditional house. But my mom at age six gave us cod liver oil every day. At that time, we cursed her. We cursed having cod liver oil. To this day, our family, cod liver oil, fish oil, vitamin D oil. She planted the seed in me at age six that, you know, over 40 years later, my kitchen looks the same. We have probiotics. We have fish oil. We just switched to cod liver oil for a change up. I love variety. It's good for your gut microbiome. But my mom and dad really instilled upon me. They've long left the planet now. My dad in 2010, my mom in 2016. But they were very shy, down-to-earth people. My dad, a carpenter. My mom, a stay-at-home mom. They would never get up in front of people, ever. Don't ask me how I get up in front of thousands of people. But I am the living embodiment, social embodiment of their message. And I feel I'm never alone on stage. People ask, "Do you get nervous?" And I'm like, "No, my mom's up here. My dad is up here. And I am, you know, basically being carried on their shoulders with their passion for health and living well." And it's a testament to them, Gary. So thank you for helping me share my mom and dad's message. And they talk about the circle of life. And the cycle of life is going. Like, you know, I am sharing what my mom and dad talked about growing up, you know, back in England and then in Canada. And yeah, it's a wonderful thing. And I really thank you for what you do with the Thriving Dentist Show and bringing crazy, amazing, current, cutting edge information to listeners around the world. Like, are you at 200 countries now? Or what are you at now?
We're at 170 countries. Okay. We've got, according to the UN, there's 195 countries recognized by the UN. So we've got 25 countries left. So as you're listening to this, if you have friends and acquaintances in some of the more obscure countries, tell them about the Thriving Dentist Show, because I would love to be the first dental podcast, nice, to get to all 195 countries. Hey, Uche, while we're, you know, talking about connecting, would it be all right if our, listeners reached out to you via email? Or yeah, social sure. media, or what's, how's the best, yeah, if they want to connect with you, how's the best way?
I think Instagram. I think Facebook, I need to turn it into a business page. I've maxed out my 5,000 friends, but they are allowed, if they look at my name, Uche Odiatu, right, they are allowed to follow me, and they are allowed to look at I make almost all my posts public, so they can look at them, comment on them, and share them. Right. But so Facebook is one way. The other way is Instagram. You know, I have 1,700 followers. You know, Dwayne The Rock Johnson has 120 million, so you can't max out on Instagram.
Right.
So,
I'll put a link. I'll put your Instagram link, on the show notes, so that they can connect to you, on Instagram. That would be great.
You can send me messages. I've allowed people to send me messages. They can comment on them. They can reply. I answer back to everyone within 48 hours. I love having my finger on the pulse, because I find many times if you're in front of 1,000 people for an hour and I give people what I think they need, well, by answering questions and messages in the weeks prior, I get a better idea of what the current, you know, pulse points are for smart people. So I can make a more personalized, designed lecture or keynote by answering messages. So I don't ignore them. I know some experts say, I'll get back to you, and no one gets back to them. But within 48 hours, sometimes if I'm in the mood, and I answer Instagram comments and questions as I go on the fly, if I'm waiting at the gate or, you know, at lunch. And I love having my fingers on the pulse of what people want to know about. And it gives me a chance to, oh, wow, I didn't know fibromyalgia. And I'll look up on, you know, what's about that. And I'll talk about, you know, probiotics and gut health. And it's my way of staying current. I love it.
So there's an invitation to our listeners. Reach out to Uche on Instagram. I'll put a link in the show notes. You can find the show notes at thrivingdentist.com. Just scroll down and you'll find a link. One click will take you directly to Uche's Instagram. Send him a DM on Instagram and stay connected with one of your mentors when it comes to health and wellness. Well, hey, on that note, I want to take a minute and say thanks to all of our listeners. I love doing this Thriving Dentist show. It's my way to contribute back to the profession. I appreciate each and every one of you as a listener. There's three things you can do to support our work. Number one, you can tell a colleague about the Thriving Dentist show. There's many dentists that have never heard the word podcast. Hey, tell them about podcasts and tell them about the Thriving Dentist show. Second thing you can do is you can jump on iTunes and write us a review. Review on iTunes works for us very much like a Google review works for your practice. And the third thing that you can do is you can hit the subscribe button. You can do that on iTunes, or you can do that on Google Play, or whatever your podcast directory of choice is. There's a subscribe button. Hit that subscribe button, and that means every Wednesday when we upload a new show, it'll be automatically uploaded to your listening device for your convenience. On that note, let me simply say thank you. Thank you, Uche. Thanks for all that you do. Thank Carrie for me. Thanks for all that. I love her inspiration as well. And let me also thank the listeners. Thank you so much for being a loyal listener, and I look forward to connecting with you on the next Thriving Dentist Show.
When you cry, be sure to dry your eyes, 'cause better days are sure to come. When you smile, be sure to smile wide, and don't let them know that they have won. And when you walk, walk with pride. Don't show the hurt inside, because the pain will soon be gone. And when you dream, dream big, as big as the ocean blue. When you dream, it might come true. When you dream, dream big.